So as I was saying, although I don't think any of you heard me, welcome to cold and rainy Toulouse, actually. The last time I was here, it was extremely hot, it was about 35 degrees. Yesterday it was about 25, and today it dropped to about 8. So it's the temperatures dropped overnight with the inevitable pinging of strings. So I may have to do some retuning. I appear to not have muted that, so I can hear myself, which is very strange. So yes, huge welcome to all of you, and a huge thank you to the School of Advanced Studies and the Open World Research Initiative for inviting me again to do round two of the Harp in Translation, where I'll be talking about the harp, one of my favourite subjects, and music and its relationship with language, which is one of my other favourite subjects. So hopefully I will illustrate this appropriately with pieces that demonstrate some of the points I'm trying to make. So without further ado, I'm going to play you a piece. And whilst you're listening to this piece, I'd like you to maybe have a think about where you think this piece is from, or when it's from, or just any information you might think about this piece. I'd like you to just have a think, and if you have any ideas, if you don't, that's right, if you have any ideas, put them in the chat, because we'll then talk about what you say. So this is my my mystery piece. Thank you. I'm just going to have a look at the iPad and see if anyone has given me any suggestions. We have, is it from Japan? It is not from Japan. At least I don't think it is. So the interesting thing to me about this piece is I actually haven't got the faintest idea where this piece is from. I remember this piece, I heard it many, many years ago on a cassette that a friend gave me that she recorded herself from I don't know where. And the reason I played this piece is because it brings up some very interesting points about musical language. Now, the original piece, I have the advantage because I know that the original recording of the piece was played on some kind of instrument that sounded vaguely like a zither, something it was definitely wire string. And the melody, this, was sung by a female voice in a language that I couldn't begin to understand. So these things sort of tell me certain things. This, the use of the zither suggests to me Central to Eastern Europe, where that kind of instrument is very popular. The fact that it's a language I didn't understand at all, not even remotely, suggests to me that it was probably something Slavic. But we are talking about a very, very long time ago. But the point is that musical language, different areas do have their own very distinct musical languages. But I don't understand, as I previously said, I don't understand any Slavic language whatsoever. In fact, when I hear them, I'm utterly bamboozled. And yet, this music posed no problem to me whatsoever to hear. Now, I'm not saying it was necessarily a traditional piece, but that is very interesting, that I can go, me as a Western European, I can go to China and roughly understand, at least join in the conversation musically with other musicians. I could probably manage to clap along to a basic African drum beat. Now, obviously, different musical cultures develop in many, many different ways and they get very, very complex. So I'm not for a moment suggesting that everyone everywhere can understand all musical languages, but the fact that we can even begin to dream of joining in the conversation fairly quickly is to me really quite a remarkable thing. And as someone who's learnt lots of languages as an adult, well, I say lots, who's studied a few languages as an adult and has lived in at least two different countries where the language is very different, being France and Japan, and struggling to communicate, this idea that suddenly this is musical language, I can just join in, and it's almost a relief. But what is going on here? So what do you have? What makes up musical language? So I'm just going to talk a little bit, firstly about the harp. I realise I haven't actually introduced the harp. I sort of assume everyone I know knows about harps, but in case you are unfamiliar with the instrument, this instrument here, this beautiful instrument, is called the lever harp, also known as the small harp, the folk harp, the clasach, the Celtic harp. In some places it's the Irish harp. I think I've covered all the bases there. I personally prefer the term lever harp because it has these levers here, which enable me to change key. The orchestral harp that you will, the big, big 6 foot tall orchestral harp will have pedals to do the same thing. It's just a different way of achieving a very similar objective of changing key on obtaining all of the 12 notes in the Western scale. Now that's an interesting place to start, because why do we have 12 notes? So just to go to sort of the fundamentals of music is, if you have a note and it reverberates at a certain frequency, if I cut the note in half, thus doubling the frequency, I will get a tone that's an octave higher. Now, pretty much every culture that has music has the octave, at least I'm sure, I think all of them do, and the fourth and the fifth. And the question is why? So in order to answer this question, I'm going to take us right back to ancient China, where the earliest record we have in China of tuning instruments is a written record in about 600 BC, by which time these had been in use for presumably a very long period of time to make it into the annals. And what they would have, they would have a series of pipes, and one bamboo pipe would give you a tone. If you blow into it very strongly, you've probably all done this with a recorder at school, if you blow into it very strongly, you'll get a fifth above. If you take another pipe and tune it to the fifth above and overblow it, you'll get a fifth above that, and so on and so forth. So they're in, I think the ratio is 3-2, they're always 3-2 in sizes going up or going down, whichever way you go. So this is sort of mathematically precise tuning. So if you go from the C to the G, if you go up in fifths all the way, you will eventually come round full circle and you will hit C again, but not quite. And this is the really interesting part. You will actually hit approximately a quarter tone above C. So whilst most musical cultures use all of these notes because they're there in physics, different musical cultures find different way to address this issue with the fact that you'll end up slightly out of tune if you just go around the full circle. And they gave these tuning pipes and eventually these tuning bells, they gave them very interesting names, like I think one of them was it's like old regulator or something like that, which suggests that they had a way of adjusting this tuning. So why am I talking about this? Because from these 12 notes, we get our scales, or we choose particular notes to use out of these 12 to get our particular scales, and which notes we choose to use entirely depends on the musical culture. A scale that we associate very often with East Asian music, particularly Chinese music, is what in the West we know as the pentatonic scale. As the name suggests, it has 5 notes. As you can see, it contains the fundamental and the fifth. And I can make a nice major arpeggio out of it, should I need to. So I'm going to play you a few pieces now, 2 Chinese and 2 Western, all of which use this pentatonic scale. It is not something that is only used in the Far East, for example. I'm pretty certain that most musical cultures have used this scale. So I'm going to retune my harp because it has this ability of, I can actually tune it in this very pretty pentatonic scale. And if there are any harpists watching, you will all know this first piece. This is called Purple Bamboo, and it is on the grade 1 syllabus. I think it is still on the grade 1 syllabus 20 years later. It's very, very well known, but it's a beautiful illustration of how the harp does the pentatonic scale very well. The pieces after that, there's a piece called Mo Li Hua, which is a Chinese folk song. And then after that, you'll probably recognise the other pieces, so I will say no more. Thank you. at least some of you recognise the last two snippets, pieces that I played there were Morning and Ye Banks and Braes. So, it's fascinating to me that even though I don't speak a word of Chinese, this sort of Chinese musical language is really quite comprehensible to me in some ways. Obviously, there are many, many things about it that I don't understand and that I sort of don't grasp. So one thing that is particularly common in Chinese music is unison. The idea of everybody playing in unison and decorating the melody is part of that language. And that's something that I actually struggle with when translating that type of music onto the harp. As you see, I want to put an accompaniment to it because that's part of my musical language. That's how, sort of in my head, melodies go with accompaniments. And also in the West, we have this idea of putting accompaniments. Do we have a technical issue? Or do we have an escapist cat? One moment. We may have a technical issue. We have a small technical issue. Just refresh your tea, ladies and gentlemen, please. Ah, we have a delay. Syncing issue. How are we doing? And now we have an escaped cat. Okay, so we'll carry on. My cat's a bit of a Houdini, if any of you saw the tweets earlier. He does like to eat my fingers as I play. So, where was I? Yes, and it's this accompanying language and this sort of the chords and the notes that we choose to use in this give a very, very different flavour.
So sorry, everyone.
Excuse us. We have it's live TV, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, so if the cat comes along, just wave at him. He likes the attention. So cat is captured, all is good. Yes, it's the notes that we tend to use in these scales which give the flavour to this musical language. And in Western music, this often comes out in the notes which we choose to use in the accompanying part, which suggest a different scale. So we're going to revisit Ye Banks and Braes of Bonnie Doon, which was at least known in the 18th century, possibly. There seems to be much of debate about the origin of this piece. But Robert Burns put words to it, but somebody also said in one of Robert Burns' diaries, it is written that someone knew this tune in 1650. So there you go. There's lots of debate about where this tune actually came from. So we're going to revisit this tune in two different styles. And we're still in this pentatonic. This hasn't changed. What is going to change is the accent, the vocabulary slightly. And you'll know, as soon as it changes, you will know. So. Thank you. Again, you notice the shift there from these F naturals in one particular mode to the F sharps. And it really does change the feel of it, I think, if you use this sort of slightly different vocabulary. To me, it's almost akin to just translating into a slightly different voice. But I mean, we're using metaphors all the way here, I suppose, but it's, again, I think it's quite helpful to me to think of it in these terms. So we've looked at this pentatonic scale and this common one that we've had. But there are whole 12 notes to choose from, and there's many, many different scales in many, many different cultures. But I just want to very quickly visit a different pentatonic scale, simply because I think it's really nice and I think it's really interesting. So the one that we've just had contains. Get there eventually. These notes. So we have our octave, we have our fifth or our fourth, if you turn it the other way. We have these all important notes. We also have the third, but this particular scale emits these two. So we've changed the G, you probably can't see my strings very well, but we've changed the G and the D for an A and an E. So instead of, we have perfectly valid choice of five notes out of these possible 12. And I'm just going to play you a very quick little tune in this, which is from Okinawa. It's a traditional Okinawan children's song. But in Okinawa music, this scale comes up all the time. It really sort of, to me, when I hear it, I think of that particular area. I'm just going to check that we haven't got any issues. Nope, no complaints so far. And also hello from all of you people who are saying hello, thank you. So I'm going to play you this, a very quick little children's song from Okinawa, basically, because I think it's quite sweet. Traditionally, this would be accompanied by the sanshin, which is an instrument akin to the shamisen, which is a sort of, I hesitate to call it a guitar-like instrument. It's essentially a small box about this big, usually traditionally in Japan covered in cat skin. Hope the cat didn't hear that. In Okinawa, it's covered in snake skin, and it has three strings and no frets, and you slide it along and you play it with a hard, usually wooden or bone plectrum, so it's quite a stringent sound, that sort of a sound. So when translating this onto the harp, I'll come to this in a bit, when translating this kind of thing onto the harp, I have to think, how am I going to do this? So I tend to try and pluck with the nails, but I just cut them, so we shall see. So this is an Okinawan folk song. Thank you. when arranging this piece for the harp, or trying to arrange it, I found that it, to me, doesn't actually translate terribly well. There are many things that work very, very well on the harp, but how would I translate the idea that this unison is so sort of striking in the original when you have a voice and the accompanying instrument? Because, as I said before, my sort of Western instinct is to put some kind of accompaniment to it. But as soon as I do that, so for example, so far so comprehensible, hopefully to most of us. But what am I doing here? I'm using this note which doesn't belong in that scale. So to me, instantly, it just changes the flavour of it, even though it's quite pretty. Is it a good translation? I'm not sure. Maybe it's just a version. Step further, and one of the things in that first piece to me that suggested it was possibly Eastern Europe was this use of the inversions, this sort of I couldn't tell you why, but something about that just suggests sort of Eastern European music to me, or possibly going a little bit further over into Russia. So I could take this even further and completely retranslate it. Harmony, a different type of musical language, will give something a very, very different flavour. So I'd just like to talk about other translingual elements of music, because that is the theme of this particular strand of the Open World Research Initiative's project. So translingual elements are elements that make sense, that are comprehensible and can be used in more than one language, the same element. So we've talked already about the fact that octaves are sort of universally comprehensible amongst all musical cultures, so far as I am aware. And we've also got this idea of rhythm, a simple, you know, one, two, three, four, or even just a one, two, one, two, is fairly universal, obviously, as cultures develop. As I said, you get fantastically complicated things rose out of this. But these fundamentals are all there. Another really interesting thing, a sort of law, I suppose, is if any of you have come across a law called Zipf's law, which is a mathematical law, which was not, I don't think it was discovered by, but it was popularised by a guy called Zipf, unsurprisingly. And it basically says that the most commonly occurring element in any, he was using books, so the most commonly occurring word occurs twice as often as the second most commonly occurring word, which occurs twice as often as the third most commonly occurring, and so on and so forth. So it's a law of distribution, essentially. Now, what to me is really interesting is this also, allegedly, from the studies I have seen, applies to music, and not just Western European music. This has been tried with different music from different cultures, or different types of music, and it seems to hold true. Which is just fascinating that there's this other sort of underlying, as well as these physical properties of vibrations and frequencies, there's this other sort of law underlying it, which I just think is really interesting. So we've looked at music as not specifically a language, because you can't say specific things in it. I can't ask you to pour me more tea, please, in musical language. Could music be considered a code? And my very unscientific definition of a code is something that contains more information than it reasonably should. So as a friend of mine put it, if you stack two major thirds and a minor third on top of them, to all of us now probably, or many of us, that probably says big guys with big guns. It's kind of a musical code, which is sort of somewhere between a language and a meaningless thing. So how do we interpret these codes? We interpret these codes and this musical language because of things we know and the sort of musical culture that we have around us. You know, we have the code book just through exposure. And what is interesting, that exposure helps you to like something. So if you can play someone a random sequence of notes and then several more random sequences of notes. And if you play the first one, or you play one they've already heard, they're more predisposed to like that one, even if it doesn't contain any melody or any rhythmic interest. And this leads really nicely onto something that occurs again in many musical cultures, which is this idea of theme and variation. You play a theme, maybe it's a popular tune, maybe the audience has never heard it, and then you variate on it. So I'm going to play you now a Welsh theme and variations. It's a very, very popular thing to do in Welsh music. And then we're going to come on to a Japanese theme and variations, which is definitely a theme and variations, but not as we would necessarily understand it. So here is variations on a Welsh carol melody. Thank you. So there you have a very sort of Western style, what we would think of as a very conventional theme and variations. You have a theme and then you change the melody around, you maybe change the accompanying chords. Excuse me one moment, just to do a slight retune. Now, this idea of theme and variations, as I say, comes up in lots of different musical cultures. So now I'm going to play you a theme and variations from 17th century Japan. So this piece is actually written for the Japanese koto, which is the floor harp. We would translate it roughly as floor harp. It's a long instrument and you play it usually kneeling on the floor. It has 13 strings and you play them with sort of false nails or plectrums which are attached to the fingers, usually just these three fingers. And it has a very strident sound because you have to hit each string enough that your hand will then rest on the next one. So immediately this is a bit of a problem as how to translate this onto the harp. So hopefully you'll see my interpretation of this and playing in a slightly different style from normal. It's much more sort of strident style with lots of stopping of the notes to try and translate this style of playing and this sound. The koto in this particular piece, so the koto can be retuned, it has a series of movable bridges. It can be retuned to whatever scale you like. This is in a tuning called Hirajoshi, which is sort of standard tuning, and it is tuned thus. Bottom note, next note. We'll get there eventually. So the bottom note is actually higher than the note above it, so you have this note twice. So that's our scale, which is a pentatonic. Different pentatonic again, so there's lots of them. Which isn't, of course, to say it can only use these notes. You can bend the notes by pushing or pulling on the string. And going back to what I was saying about how in a lot of Eastern music, a lot of East Asian music, decorating the melody was more important than putting an accompaniment to it. You will see that in this, there isn't really what we would recognise as an accompaniment, but it is nonetheless not remotely lacking for this. And in the original, the notes are decorated in all manner of different ways. And I thought very, very hard about how to interpret this on the harp. And one particular feature of the koto is that it can bend notes both up and down by sort of pushing on the string. You can, in fact, bend the note down. And it opens with what is actually a very famous opening. Dare do that in case I tune it badly, but that is how the opening is supposed to go. And then this sort of idea of bending these notes down does come up quite often, so have that in your head. I have to use some interesting techniques like damping strings and striking others to get the same effect. This is possibly the piece in a lifetime of memorizing music that has been the most difficult piece to memorize, because it doesn't, even though the notes of it are sort of comprehensible and the rhythm, there's nothing fundamentally not in my vocabulary, but the way it is put together, the sort of sentence structure, if you will, of this piece is completely different to anything that I'm used to doing. So I did find it very hard to navigate. So just look, a couple of tips to help you navigate this piece, because it is quite different. It's in six variations. It's called Rokuden no Shirabe, which basically means piece in six steps, in six parts, in six variations. They get progressively quicker as you're going along. They all contain, at the beginning, some kind of play on this, these bottom notes. Some of the variations contain this E natural here, but not all of them. There's a lot of octaves. So hopefully that just gives you a few guide points so you'll know maybe when the next variation has begun. So sit back and enjoy Rokudan no Shirabe.
Thank you.
So hopefully you didn't feel too lost, but you may have felt a little bit lost in the middle of that. I've been learning these pieces for quite a long time now, and it took me a really long time to sort of appreciate the subtleties of it, because, as I say, the sort of musical language is very, it's not really part of my vocabulary, but I found that this sort of, I started using this in other pieces, that bit of rhythm, so I guess that sort of stuck. Just going to check the chat. Which levers were up for this piece? The Japanese piece, it is approximately in G minor, so my A levers are up if your harp is tuned in E flat. So B flat major, but the actual piece was in G minor with additional other lever changes. I have made a transcription of this from the original Koto tablature. If anyone is interested, I'm happy to send it on, although it's a bit, it's not remotely edited. It was basically just so I could learn it without having to interpret the Koto tablature, which is in Japanese, which was quite, I couldn't sight read it, basically. So one of the reasons, as I say, this piece was so hard to me was partly just because the way it was constructed was so alien to me, but also this idea of rhythm. It's written, this type of music is written in blocks of four. They sell essentially blank sheet music for Koto. I have never seen it not in groups of four. Now, whether or not this means there is no music of this type in three time or not, I have no idea. I've never seen it. And certainly I've not really come across many Japanese pieces that are in 3-4 until the 19th century. I don't know enough to say for certain that no music was ever in 3-4, but it's an interesting point. But to me, none of the notes that to me landed on the strong beat when I made a transcription were on the strong beat. There's so much sort of syncopation, this sort of you'd expect that to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or something. But I think it starts on the 2 or something. So I had to sort of just toss all that out of the window and just learn it as notes. So there was not sort of much to hang on to. I suppose in Western musical parlance to say that the time signature kept changing. But every piece takes up the same amount of space on the page. They're all equal length, which again is quite interesting. They just get faster. And all the notes are the same apart from the dotted ones, which are notated slightly differently. They're all the same value. But it's not just Japanese music that has this. It's not some sort of special magical thing. Syncopation exists in many cultures, specifically famously in jazz music in the West. But in all cultures, this idea of playing with the beat, of hiding the strong beat, it's fun, it's exciting. It enables you to sort of feel a sense of, oh, I got it. And honestly, the idea of putting in bar lines that we're used to is actually quite relatively modern in terms of, you know, human civilization. And it reminded me, this particular piece reminded me very strongly of a lute piece that I played and sang many, many years ago by John Dowland. And this again had a very similar sort of hiding of where the strong beat was. And if you look at a modern transcription with bar lines, it does, as a Japanese one does, it does sort of match up, and eventually it all comes round full circle and the beat ends up where you want it to be. But the middle is just this sort of, to me, it just seems to sort of coast. And it's almost scary to play because there's nothing to kind of grab onto. So I'm going to play this anyway, and you can maybe just see, maybe I'm just drawing strange conclusions here, but I just think that the similarity to me was interesting, and I had the same difficulty with both of them. So just checking, we haven't got any. Yep, all good so far. So this is Weep You No More, Sad Fountains by John Dowland. Thank you. A really beautiful piece of music, but it does have this slightly awkward timing. So we've looked at notes, the scale, how that arises. We've looked briefly at rhythm. What I haven't mentioned, and I just want to mention this because I find it quite funny, is I talked at the beginning about these Chinese pitch pipes and how the length of these pipes, I don't think I mentioned this, the length of these pipes was actually used as their standard measurement throughout the empire. So when the pipe length was decided, the length of this was determined by astrology and astronomy and some sort of, I believe, some kind of ceremony they did with the ground and making sure that basically the whole empire was in tune with the sort of celestial world, which is just great to begin with. And the fact that they based their weights and measure system on essentially a musical instrument is kind of amazing. But this pitch would change. It was we understand it now based on surviving bells to have been, it sort of wavered from somewhere between middle C and F, so this sort of range. And that got me thinking about, you know, how we get our scale and why we tune it the way we do. And this led to, there is a wonderful conspiracy theory. Some people believe that we choose A as 440. A was chosen as 440 by the Nazis as a form of mind control, because apparently 440 is a very aggressive frequency. And we should all, in fact, be tuning at 432 hertz as A. And there's all manner of things that come out there when you start looking at this. But as much as I hate to disappoint the conspiracy theorists, was in fact the Italians in 1885 who decided that A should be standardised at 440. And personally, I think it was to annoy the French, who tuned at 432. It wasn't until, in fact, 1953 that it was sort of worldwide. I think it was the Americans who essentially said we should all be tuning at 440. And at that time in history, certainly what America did, the rest of the world tended to follow. But there's just sort of fascinating ideas about frequencies and why certain pitches behave in certain ways and why we like them. But what I haven't talked a huge amount about is musical context. And in the same way that words can have different meanings in different contexts, you know, you need the whole phrase to put the particular words into the right context. The same thing can happen with music. And I, a little while back, I'm going to play you just a short piece. I was learning this jazz piece, and I have to admit, I found the harmony very, very difficult to grasp. I just couldn't sort of make head and tail of it. You know, I've got this chord. Okay, I understand that. That's a good chord. I've got this chord. I've got this chord. Okay, I understand all this. And then you put different bass notes to it. And I was finding it very, very hard to interpret this, because the bass note would change the context of the top chord. But when I finally put it together, I realised that this sort of, my brain had started to understand this musical vocabulary, and it's also a very beautiful tune, so I'm going to play just the melody for you. So this is Nema. I could attempt to then improvise around that theme and those chords, but hopefully you could hear how these chords change the context of the bass note and vice versa. Again, I think it's just a very interesting thing that this works in a similar way, you could argue, to language. So lastly, we talked about many, many elements of music, but lastly I'd like to talk about timbre, which is possibly, I think I said last time, it's one of the elements that is possibly the most difficult for us to reinterpret. Or to understand. If we find something that's a hard timbre to listen to, it becomes difficult to listen to. And possibly, I could argue that one of the difficulties that people had with, you know, when electric guitars came on the scene, wasn't necessarily the chords that were being played, because they were probably very simple tunes, but this sort of, this new timbre that was just unfamiliar. And certainly, if I listen to... very often it's singing from other cultures and traditional ways of singing, it can sound very, very strange to us. So the Okinawan song that I played you before, I heard in concert by a famous Okinawan quartet of four female singers, and they basically sing entirely in unison, which again is very different from us. If we had four singers, there would be some harmony. But it was very, very beautiful, but it took me a little while during the concert to get used to this sort of the way they were singing. Timbre can be difficult to understand, but the harp happens to have a very lovely timbre. So I'm now going to play a piece of classic rock music to finish off with. It translates very well to the harp simply because it's in a nice sort of key, and it's in a nice mode that goes particularly well on the harp. You can play all sorts of rock and pop music on the harp, and it will sound like a harp. So I don't think this piece needs a huge amount of introduction, so I'm just going to go ahead and play it, and I hope very much that you enjoy I hope that we're not having too many technical issues. I am seeing no technical issues, so I hope that we're good. So here we go.
Thank you.
So that was quite hopefully evidently Stairway to Heaven. And it was really fun to take this rock piece, which starts off quite comparable to the harp with this plucking, and then try and emulate the different sounds that come through in that. Obviously I couldn't get the lovely effects at the end, but it's such good fun to me to try and interpret these things and try and translate them onto the harp. So my iPad seems to have frozen, so I'm not sure if that means that nobody is there or that everyone is there and you have no comments or questions. Is everything working up there? Quick question to tech support. If you have any questions or comments, could someone say something so that I know this is working or not? Because we are now in hopefully the time for Q&A. If anybody has anything they'd like to know about the harp, or any questions about music and language that I can attempt to answer. I am still getting nothing on here, I am afraid. Bear with me one moment, we seem to be having maybe some technical issues. I may just need to grab a different device so I can see if anybody has any questions. Could I possibly have another device to see if there are any questions, please? Bear with you one moment, refresh your glass of wine or tea. And the cat might just make an appearance. I'm awfully sorry, this seems to have frozen. Do we have any questions?
Yes.
Ah, thank you. I'm so sorry if I seem to have been ignoring you. I'm awfully sorry, there's so much chat here that I didn't see. Thank you.
Could I possibly have another device if there are any questions?
Now this is, right. Sorry, I'm miles behind now with these. Thank you, now I have my other device. Thank you all for your clapping and lovely comments. That's a lovely. How are different scales and different cultures used to display emotions? Is a question that I don't think I can answer in the next 10 minutes. Certainly in Western music, we're very used to the idea of major being happy and minor being But I honestly couldn't say for certain if that holds in all different cultures. I suspect that it probably does not. Excuse me, but I'm afraid I would have to do more research on that. But certainly for us, minor modes tend to be sad and major modes tend to be happy. There was another question further back. I'm sorry, I'm absolutely lost with this because it's been frozen, I think, for the past half an hour. Yes, an emotional code. Yes, exactly, going back to what we're talking about, codes. I could play... hands. And for many of us, that code is, ooh, something's coming. It's not encoded in language. You can't say, ooh, something's coming, but that implies, you know, something's coming. So I think you could definitely imply an emotional code, and quite probably the loop piece that I played earlier contains emotional codes of which I am unaware. We have a furry friend come to join us. Hello, Shibia. Are there any more questions? Does anybody have any more questions? Just wait a moment, because there is a slight delay. I am not seeing any more questions coming through. Which is very nice. It means that I have told you everything you want to know about the harp and languages, and music and translation. So if there are no more questions, I'm really paranoid now that this isn't working. So if anyone has any more questions afterwards, please, please do feel free to get in touch. Send me a message or contact me via one of the many electronic means of communication that we now have. If anybody wants pictures of the cat, they'll probably go up on Twitter later. It remains for me just to thank you all so much for listening and bearing with my explanations. And hopefully it was interesting, and hopefully there were some things there that you didn't know, or at least I've given you some food for thought, because obviously a lot of this is sort of metaphorical, but I find it a very helpful way for me personally as a linguist and a musician to think about the way I treat music when I'm translating it from one culture into another, or one instrument, or one timbre, or one style into another. How would I define different musical languages? Oh, sorry, this has all just come through in a row. How would I define different musical languages? That is a fascinating question, and I have to admit, I haven't really got a definition. I suppose I would think of it in terms of, I tend to think of it in terms of musical vocabulary, and there are things from that vocabulary that make up a language, if that makes a sort of sense. So you might get a specific rhythm coupled with a specific scale, and that says very strongly a particular musical culture, or you'll get a musical culture where this rhythm and that scale and this type, and the fact that you're using an accompaniment forms that sort of musical language. You could equally talk about your musical language in terms of these: which modes do you use? Which scales do you use? I think there's many different ways to define it. So I'm sorry, that's not actually a terribly coherent answer, but I tend to group things into the elements of music. So rhythms and pitch and melody, and the scales or modes, or the way these are all then grouped together will create a language. And I think part of the sort of point of this is that so many of these are comprehensible across many musical cultures, that they sort of, you can join in another musical language in a way that you can't with a spoken language. So I hope that helps. Some pieces easier to learn for music newcomers who are not familiar with musical codes, like the ones you found difficult. Definitely, I would say if you're a newcomer to music, I would start with either a piece that is familiar to you, so a song that you already know, if you can sing it, you're already halfway there because you've got it in your head, or something from a musical culture that you're familiar with. I would not recommend somebody new to memorising music to start with Rokudan no Shirabe. I, halfway through rehearsing this piece, did wonder why I had ever started this quest. And I'm immensely pleased that I did, but it certainly I would choose something you're familiar with. I'm sorry, the South American comment has come through, but I'm not quite sure what it's a good example of, because I've slightly delay. If you could possibly elaborate on that, that would be really helpful. And thank you all so much for your incredibly lovely comments. As I say, hopefully I've taken you on a musical journey. And also, frankly, I feel like part of my job as a lever harpist is to show you what the lever harp can really do. Because it's, at least where I am, it's not a very common in an instrument, and many people think of the pedal harp when they think of harps, and they're just two very different instruments. I'm particularly lucky to have this lovely instrument. I believe the person who made this instrument is in fact watching, so thank you very much to Telenai TV, because it is just, I don't know where I would be without it, really. And the whole world is watching. Yes, thank you. I'm seeing people from all over. I'm absolutely astounded, frankly, and incredibly grateful that you've all tuned in from all over, wherever you happen to be. If anything good has come out of this, of 2020, and the crazy situation we seem to have found ourselves in, while it's sad not to be with a live audience, it's nice to be able to talk to so many people all over the world and have these conversations. And I've met some fascinating people virtually who have really helped me understand things I didn't understand before and widen my musical vocabulary and start these conversations. So thank you to all of you. Some of you are watching. And a huge, huge thanks again to the School of Advanced Studies and Elizabeth for being so calm whilst I was having technical issues and for helping me smooth those out, and generally just being very, very helpful, making sure this all went off without a hitch. And to the Open World Research Initiative again for this whole programme, this whole series of concerts and lectures, for organising all of this, because there have been some really, really fantastic events. So thank you ever so much. For all of this, and thank you for watching. I think I will let you all go and have your glasses of wine or your tea or whatever it is, or your cocktails that you're gonna end your Friday evenings with. Thank you ever so much, and a very good night.